But first, in the race for the White House, tensions are heating up in South Carolina. Our political director, Lisa Desjardins, reports.
The Republican 2016 race, already full of twists and turns, took one more today when South Carolina Governor Nikki Haley announced she's endorsing Marco Rubio 4 days before the state's primary. Otherwise, the contest has become a blur of blistering attacks. Starting with the man at the top, Donald Trump. Target, Ted Cruz. Cruz has said that Trump is not truly conservative. Cruz has a series of anti-Trump ads that make the point.
Cruz said,
Today in Bluffton, South Carolina, Trump again shot back.
You can't lie about people like that. It's just incredible. And again, I've been in business, and I've dealt with some pretty rough hombres, much tougher than Cruz. But I've never dealt with anybody that lied so much.
As for Cruz, consider it the third law of politics. Every Trump attack gets an equal and opposite counterattack.
Look, ethics matter.
Today, the Texas senator went after Trump's attempt to block his ads.
Mr. Trump has sent me a legal cease and desist letter saying, stop telling the voters my record. Now, that is objectively legally frivolous.
But this is not a two-man war, and Cruz is also targeting fellow Senator Marco Rubio.
When you have Donald Trump and Marco Rubio repeatedly putting forth fabrications with no evidence, no basis whatsoever, just trying to throw mud and attack.
Rubio is more focused in his attacks on fellow Senator Cruz and defense spending.
Some people talk to me and say, well, why vote for you and not Ted Cruz? Well, Ted Cruz voted for a budget that cut it even more. I'm not cutting defense spending when I'm president.
Jeb Bush may not be in the top three right now, but he's not to be left out, firing away in Beaufort today at Trump, Rubio, and John Kasich.
With all due respect, Senator Rubio, your 4 years or 5 years or whatever it is as senator does not match up to my capabilities of understanding how the world works. Donald Trump says we don't need to spend more money on the military. And John Kasich has a similar kind of view. They're wrong.
Kasich, he kept his distance from the scrimmage, hoping a positive message wins.
Let's not be negative about the future of our country or negative about our country today. We're doing fine.
The Democrats were less sharp-edged, but Hillary Clinton in Chicago did seem to dig at her rival, Bernie Sanders.
We need a president, yes, who's passionate about getting as much as possible money out of politics and reigning in Wall Street, but we need a president who's passionate about creating jobs and raising incomes like I am.
Sanders left the campaign trail briefly today, returning to Vermont. Up next, candidates in both parties hit national television for town halls the next two nights. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Lisa Desjardins.
Just 3 days away from the next voting contest, we turn our attention to Nevada, where Sanders and Clinton will face off for the third time, as well as South Carolina, which we just heard about. Joining us tonight from Las Vegas is John Ralston of Ralston Live, and from South Carolina, Randy Covington. He's a professor of journalism at the University of South Carolina. He's also the former news director of WIS Television in Columbia. Gentlemen, welcome to you both. Let's start with the Democrats and Nevada. John Ralston, the race has tightened up there between Clinton and Sanders. What has happened? Why?
Well, Hillary Clinton had the state locked up. She came here early last year, set up an infrastructure, hired all these operatives from 2008 who had worked here. She reached out to the Latino community. Bernie Sanders was invisible here. His campaign didn't even arrive until late last year. But then slowly the tide became turning. He started to turn. He raised a lot of money, put resources in here, spent money on TV. And then after New Hampshire, Judy, the tide completely turned when she lost by a landslide in New Hampshire. Her internal polls showed she was hemorrhaging. Suddenly the Clintons were making New Hampshire and Iowa seem like Nevada when it's nothing like Nevada. They said it was an all-white state, essentially. And so her campaign essentially has been in a free fall here. They've been trying to stop that, and they're hoping they have a parachute before they hit the ground on Saturday.
And just quickly, John Ralston, Hillary Clinton had shown strength among Latino voters. We know she had some strength among the labor unions. What's happened to all that?
Well, she does have strength among Latino voters here, Judy. In fact, she has had some high-profile endorsements. She has Dolores Huerta, the legendary civil rights activist, campaigning for her here today. Henry Cisneros, the former cabinet secretary, mayor of San Antonio, was here. She has a lot of local dreamers, including maybe the most famous dreamer in the country, who was on stage with President Obama. Astrid Silva has endorsed her. But Bernie Sanders has made inroads. Even the Clinton campaign acknowledges that Sanders' message is starting to resonate in the Latino community. So I think she'll win Latinos, but will she win by enough to win the caucus on Saturday?
Randy Covington, let's turn to the Democrats in South Carolina, where Hillary Clinton seems to be holding on to her lead a little better. What does it look like?
For the Democrats, there is not the passion that existed 8 years ago when Barack Obama was running. Most African-American leaders here are supporting Clinton. The Sanders message is fairly alien in a conservative state. I think it's fairly safe for Hillary Clinton here. More of the focus, more of the excitement is on the other side.
It sure is, and that's where all the, as we saw in that report from Lisa Desjardins, that's where a lot of the yelling and the TV spots are directed. Randy Covington, why is Donald Trump doing so well in South Carolina?
Well, South Carolina has a long history of being contrarian. Civil War started here when the civil rights legislation passed in the 1960s. We raised the Confederate flag on top of the State House. His message resonates in a state like this. And at a time in the nation where there's frustration over government, clearly Trump has tapped into that. And in a state that 4 years ago in this primary went for Newt Gingrich, I don't think there's anything surprising about Trump's strength.
And what about, though, the message from Ted Cruz? And we know that he and Trump are in a vicious back and forth. Who's listening? Who is responding positively to Ted Cruz?
All right. So, Judy, if I could turn the clock back 16 years, you were at CNN. I was working in television at that time. And John McCain and the Straight Talk Express came rolling into South Carolina, and then things got really interesting. And I think we're at this exact same moment today. You have the apparent front runners, however, it's much more nuanced and complicated than that. Jeb Bush, this is his last stand, and he is putting enormous strength, power, resources into this.
And meanwhile, if I could interrupt, I was going to say, you have your governor, Nikki Haley, today endorsing Marco Rubio, which is mixing things. Does that help him a lot?
Absolutely. So you have Bush, who I think is ascendant, strong debate performance. You have Rubio. Just a few minutes ago, the influential state newspaper here in Columbia endorsed Kasich. So I think this field is very much in play. Probably most people expect the insurgent message of Trump to win, but everything else is very volatile. Where I live, every day, my phone rings incessantly with robocalls. I brought in my props. This is from my mailbox in the last 2 days. Three pro-Jeb, one anti-Jeb, one anti-Trump, two anti-Rubio, one pro-Rubio. I think there's much more to unfold in the next few hours.
It sounds like it in the next few days. But meanwhile, back to Nevada and John Ralston, the Republicans are competing there 1 week later. How is that shaping up, or is everything on hold until they see how South Carolina goes?
Well, they're waiting to come here until after South Carolina, Judy. But Donald Trump is dominating here in the polls. The other campaigns that are organized here, Cruz, Bush, and Rubio, all privately acknowledge they're fighting for second place. But that could be important, depending on what happens in South Carolina. But I think Nevada is going to mirror what's happening elsewhere, that as long as there are three or four candidates running against Donald Trump, he'll get his 25, 30, 35%, and the rest are going to divide it up until someone decides decides to get out, or a couple of them decide to get out. It'll be interesting to see what happens in South Carolina, because I think that will have an impact on Nevada, but probably only on who finishes in second and third.
One thing's for sure, it's not dull. John Ralston, Randy Covington, thank you both.